BBC Sounds. Music, radio, podcasts.
3 years ago, two people had a dream.
And a couple of surprise inclusions this morning. Scott Mills and Chris Stark both come in for their Five Live debuts today.
Two plucky underdogs gained promotion to the greatest radio station in the world.
I don't think many saw this one coming.
They rule the Saturday morning airwaves.
I love your show and you make me laugh every time I listen to you.
But now, the dream is over. They've been relegated. Welcome to Scott and Chris, the final.
We've not been fired.
Yeah, we've not been fired, guys.
So, for one last time, it is us on Saturday morning on Five Live. How are you today?
Yeah, relegated suggests fired, doesn't it?
Yeah.
But we'd like to make that clear.
Yeah, left of our own accord, thank
Listen,
you.
Listen, we're going to go out on a high. You're going to love today's show. Settle in. It's going to be a good one. Robbie Williams will join us in about half an hour.
Do you know, he's on holiday in Ibiza right now, but he's interrupting his holiday to talk to us. He was one of the very first guests, if not the first guest we had on this show. Robbie's coming up later. Rugby ref Nigel Owens will referee your personal disputes for the final time. The last Real Life TMO is after 10 o'clock.
Stacey Dooley is going to be playing the Upside Down quiz with us around half 10.
And we'll have some of our favourite bits from Kids Review Their Parents' Record Collection. Listen, thank you so much for all your nice messages. Remember, in the words of Dr. Seuss, don't cry because it's over, smile because it happened.
Of course. That's, do you know, right, little peek behind the curtain, everyone. This is what this show is going to be. It's going to be us talking in constant cliches and little grabby phrases.
Yeah, we need some grabs for the press release.
Exactly.
So we need to say things like that could potentially be in a press release, if they bother.
Although, imagine that. Imagine 3 years is on Five Live and the quote in the press is,
don't cry because it's over,
smile because it happened. So Saturday morning, once a week.
The Five Live presenter said.
Yeah, exactly. Right, point of order, everyone. We're also going to announce who the new Saturday morning presenter is going to be, which is very exciting. We'll tell you who's going to be taking over this show. You're going to love it.
It's Saturday morning on Five Live. Get in touch with us. Loads of your stories coming in about the most impulsive thing you've ever done.
Alan says, I proposed to my girlfriend after 2 weeks. We're still together 25 years later. Nice one, Alan. JB just tweeted us the scissors emoji, meaning he either got an impulsive haircut or maybe an even more drastic snip.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
Think about it. 85058, Texas should charge you your standard network rate. You can tweet us at BBC Five Live.
Sports Personality of the Week is coming up. We're going to talk to Five Live Colossus Ian Dennis very soon.
Good morning, Gina. What's the most impulsive thing you've ever done?
Well, about 7 years ago, I think it was, my friend and I were watching Eurovision. We had a great time watching all the show, and we had pen friends in Sweden, so we were really pleased to see that the Swedish entry was doing really well.
Was this the year that Måns Zelmerlöw won with Heroes?
Yes, that's the one. Yeah, it was a really good show. Yeah, oh yeah, that makes sense. So we woke up in the morning, a bit worse for wear, and my friend Beck said, "I just had a message saying we've got some flights booked for Stockholm." How did that happen? When is it? So it wasn't to go for the Eurovision the next year, which would have made a bit more sense. It was 6 weeks' time to go to Stockholm. So we frantically got onto all the social media and found my pen friend. She hadn't changed her name. So we wrote to her, greet her, and said, we're coming to Stockholm. Can we meet you? And we did meet my friend, had a great time. Her brother worked in a restaurant and knew some people who owned a cocktail bar. And we just had an absolutely fabulous time.
I'm a little bit sad to hear that you found your pen pal on social media, you know, without going too technical about it. Wasn't there something quite beautiful about keeping the pen pal writing only?
Well, the pen pal writing only stopped when we were about 20. So I hadn't been in touch with her. I used to stay with her in the summer and she came over and stayed with me at Christmas. So it was pen pal up till about the age of 20 and then we just totally lost touch. So our impulse purchase of flights, watching Eurovision, has actually reconnected us.
That's so nice.
Yeah. We should connect you via social media. I mean, it sounds like the makings of a great TV show, this, where you connect people that you are pen pals with to you via social media. You give them the follow. We find them for you, and then you follow and reconnect. We could do this with some
never had a pen pal.
Of course you did. Everyone's had a pen pal at some point. Did you not have a pen pal?
Oh, actually, yes, I do. I have Leah from Fiji.
Oh, I would love to. I would do anything to get the letters. I really would.
So Leah and me had like, the rumours were we were romantically linked. I mean, we were like 10. I was devastated when Leah moved from my school in Eastleigh back to Fiji. And my mum remembers it so well. I cried so much. And then we became pen pals for a while.
Oh, this would have been so amazing for the final show, wouldn't it? For her to appear. Well, she hasn't got long. We'll give her to the end of the show, see if she appears.
Before the end of the show, let's track down Leah, who lives in Fiji.
We're not going to have another opportunity. It's now or never, Leah. Make radio gold.
I love, though, because Mons won Eurovision, you went to Stockholm. That is amazing for me.
But this year, obviously, with it being the Ukrainian Eurovision in the UK, we've already booked hotels in all of the seven locations.
Just yes, you're my girl. I love this.
What great idea. So you got cancellation on them, or have you just been massively bougie? Because this is a great idea. I reckon we should all do the same.
We have got the cancellation, so we're just waiting to see where we're going to go.
Well, have a great time in whatever city Eurovision's in next year. And I have no info, by the way.
Okay.
I'd let you know otherwise.
Well, thanks very much. And good luck for the future.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you.
I'm going to miss you on the Radio 5 Live.
Thank you very much.
So have a fab last show.
Oh. Right, Scott, who are we playing the Rocky theme for this week?
Well, it's for Susanna, who's made her coffee and back to bed for one last Saturday morning with us. And for Russell in Bromley, who says, lads, you've made me laugh so much on a Saturday morning over the last few years, especially during lockdown. Thanks for your shows. Tell Nigel Owens he's a legend. Well do, Russell. Have a happy birthday tomorrow as well.
Nice. This is for you and everyone else who needs a bit of a boost this morning. Let's go!
Here we go.
We are going to have some of our favourite kid reviewers very soon. But first, this.
This is Sports Personality of the Week.
Sports Personality of the Week.
Sports Personality of the Week.
Good morning, Five Lives Ian Dennis.
Good morning, Chris. Good morning, Scott. How are you both?
Very good, thank you. And I just saw your tweet, Ian. Mm. What a lovely tweet. It said, thoroughly enjoyed being with Scott and Chris most Saturday mornings. Hard to believe this photo, which we had taken at the very start, was 3 years ago. Time flies. Life thunders by, doesn't it?
I can't believe it was 3 years ago.
I know.
You know, and I was actually quite nervous when I met the two of you that day as well.
What do you mean?
At a broadcasting house.
That's ridiculous.
That is ridiculous. Yeah.
That's ridiculous. Go on.
And the two of you haven't got me the sack either.
No.
That's true. You're still on.
Yeah. I actually thought there'd be one time you'd say, go on, tell us that story. And I'd tell you the story. And then all of a sudden the P45 would be through.
No, because it's a gradual process. If that had happened from the start, there might have been trouble. But it's so gradual.
It's today.
Yeah, but it could be today.
Well, we do have till 11, you know.
So. Yeah. I find it, Matt, you're right to say thank you, Scott, for that message. And it's like for us, having you guys as colleagues, being able to say that is pretty awesome.
Yeah.
It was Chris Sutton tweeted recently as well, mm-hmm. something totally out of the blue. And it blows my mind, you know, us being part of this Saturday lineup and getting some respect from guys like yourselves. Yeah. So thank you so much.
You'll be missed. You'll be missed by many.
Very quickly, what's the most impulsive thing you've ever done, Denno? Here it comes.
Your producer Emily just said to me, and I said, "I'm not saying that. You will. I will get the sack. So, I'll. What is it? Is it? I'll take the Fifth Amendment. I think with that one.
Fair enough. You don't normally, and maybe you're wise to, because final show. It's all good. Loads of football happening on Five Live this weekend. Denno, where are you today?
Everton, Nottingham Forest, which is the Mark Chapman on air at 12. Then 3 o'clock is the base for all the goals as they go in around the country. Everton against Forest, and then we've got the 5:30 game, which is Bournemouth against Arsenal. And we've got two more games tomorrow, Leeds, Chelsea, and Newcastle, Manchester City. So lots of live football to look forward to.
It's true what we say, you know. We look up to you and all the guys on Five Live. I find what you do day in, day out, week in, week out, so impressive. I really do.
Oh, mate, it's so good. And it's like what Rachel sent a lovely message a while ago. Do you remember saying some lovely... We're so lucky to be part of this family.
Yeah. Can I ask, Ian, will we get all the goals as they go in later?
You will get all the goals as they go in, yeah.
Yeah, full goal service.
Full goal service.
I say that quite a bit on a Saturday afternoon.
Yeah. Harder, yeah. Better, faster, stronger than anywhere else.
That's right. Only on Five Live. It's now time for our nominations for the BBC Sports Personality of the Week. Shall I begin?
Go on,
I
Scott.
Normally do. Okay, here we go. My Sports Personality of the Week is Alan Shearer. Denno, have you seen Shearer's new hobby?
No, go on.
He started getting musical references into Match of the Day.
Yes.
He started with this one.
Closing down, time to pick the head up. Why doesn't he come on over?
Ooh.
Valerie.
Oh, dear.
Sorry, guys. Why doesn't he come on over?
Ooh.
Valerie.
Ooh.
Valerie.
So we thought that might be a one-off, but no. And last then weekend, he did this one.
And then the Everton substitute comes on and gives the ball away.
What's his name?
Oh, Nana.
Oh, no. What's his name?
Oh, Nana.
What's his name?
Oh, Nana.
What's his name?
Oh, Nana.
I think this should only be encouraged. So yeah. If anyone has any more suggestions for Alan tonight, let us know. 85058. Get him in now.
That's a good idea. Let's text the best one over to him.
So for his commitment to dad jokes, my sports personality of the week is Alan Shearer. All right. Ian Dennis, your turn. Who is your BBC sports personality of the week?
Just to continue that theme, he's got previous, you know. I'm sure that he was part of the England team.
He was, you're right.
In France 98, when they used to shoehorn song titles into pre-match interviews.
He was. They all got away with it for so long as well, didn't they? I think it was actually him. I might be wrong on this, but he was the one that ended up rumbling the whole thing, as in he went too far. Yeah, I think it was him they discovered it with.
Yeah, well, I think I've got to say, that's a hard one to beat. I've actually gone for a joint one today. And it is Vicky Pike and Martin Law, who are the treasurer and chairman, respectively, of non-league Reading City, who actually travelled to Royal Wootton Bassett Town today in the FA Cup. And I was reading this piece on the website by Neil Johnston on the BBC website. They've added Chinese food to their matchday menu. Red curry, Thai red curry, noodles, spring rolls. Now, I love a Scotch pie whenever I go to a Scottish Premiership game, but I think we should be able to do games from Reading City if they were to progress in the FA Cup. The only thing is, if they win today, they've still got another four qualifying rounds to go. But Chinese food on a match day menu means that Vicky Pike and Martin Law get my vote.
This is so good. And the last sports personality or like sporting highlight of the week is so good that you've gone for the food options at... at Reading City. Incredible.
If the chef is listening at Goodison Park, I'll take a chicken chow mein today.
Well, do you know what? FA Cup preliminary round, which I believe is today, involves Marlow. And now I know Chef Tom Kerridge is very much involved with them. So that might be another one to get yourself to, Ian Dennis, just food-wise. I'm thinking you could enjoy that one.
Is the food for the footballers, for the players?
I'm assuming it's for yourself.
It's for the fans.
All right.
The fans can turn up at Reading City and can basically have a Chinese takeaway and watch
Incredible.
The game.
Wow. Incredible.
Thank you. Thank you for your nomination, Denno.
I miss this
going
so much. It's so good.
And finally, Chris Stark, who is your sports personality of the week?
Oh, Dan, I wasn't expecting it to be Chinese food. It's awkward. I assumed your sports personality of the week nomination would be us, of course. It is our final one. And I want to make it a special nomination. So, Denno, I know you're terrible at receiving praise, but if you'd accept it, I'd like my sports personality of the week to be you, Ian Dennis. Always up for coming on this show, entertaining often what is nonsense on a Saturday morning. I knew you got us the first time we met properly when you didn't flinch at us calling you Dirty Denno. I can't really remember the context of that personally, but I really hope it's one of the things that lives on past this show. Dirty Denno. Do you remember why? No. I think, was it an idea around him reading erotic fiction?
I think it was.
Something to do with that, anyway. But I think it's fair to say, 20 years at the BBC, he's not spoken about the same way as other veterans here. David Attenborough, Ken Bruce, Scott Mills. And I want to put some respect on his name. I'm so sorry we haven't had a chance to make a papier-mâché head and bust for you, Denno. We had good intentions, didn't we?
We were going to put it in the reception at BBC Salford reception, yeah.
Yeah, because it is coming up to 20 years, and you're a legend.
Inspired by the Ronaldo bust that I saw at Madeira Airport.
Exactly. We were going to get the same sculptor, ideally.
I'd probably end up looking more like Ronaldo.
Jokes aside, I'll never forget the commentary you and Alan Shearer did for Liverpool-Barcelona, and rightfully, everyone heaped praise on it. And I find it mad I'm on the same station as you, part of a Saturday lineup that I listen to and have listened to and enjoy as being a football fan. And I have done that for many years. You have the ability to describe the game I love in a way that makes me love it even more. And that's special. So for all that and many more reasons, you're a top bloke. Big love, Denno. My sports personality of the week is Ian Dennis.
Here, here.
That's very kind. You know, at the start when I said that I think Alan Shearer would be hard to beat? Yeah. Well, I think I'm going with you, Chris. Yeah.
We mean
as long
everywhere.
As you haven't got Mark Chapman to explain Dirty Denno, then we're fine.
Yeah, yeah. We're all good. Ian Dennis, what is the best fact you've researched for today's match, please?
Well, I've got to admit, it's not a particularly good one, but there's never been two founder members of the Premier League, Everton against Nottingham Forest. And there's never been a draw in any of their 10 previous meetings. The last draw between the two was 30 years ago. Whether I actually read that out, I'm not too sure.
Okay, well, you know, you can decide on the day. Yeah. Decide tonight. Thank you, Ian, so much. You absolute ledge. Join Ian Dennis for live commentary of Everton v Nottingham Forest at 3 o'clock. Plus, all the goals as they go in. Good morning, it's Scott Mills and Chris Stark till 11. Thank you so much for making us part of your Saturday mornings over the last few years. We're off to do other things after today, but we have not been fired. But we will tell you who our new Saturday morning presenter will be a bit later on, and you will love it. Before that, we have some of our favourite kid reviewers, and Robbie Williams will join us in about 20 minutes.
We're getting loads of stories from you about the time you left somewhere early. Some of them are great. We were debating on Real Life TMO whether it's ever acceptable to leave a match or a concert before it ends, normally to beat the rush.
Yeah, Colleen says, my husband randomly got me tickets to go and see Take That. Was strange, as I hadn't really liked them since my 20s. Turned out it was at Anfield, and he's a huge Liverpool fan. Ah, I see, that's why. So we went and left just before the end to miss the crowds. What would you miss at a Take That concert? Probably Never Forget.
I think you're right.
Anyway, next morning, I hear him almost crying while looking at Twitter. Turns out Jerry Marsden had come on at the end and sung You'll Never Walk Alone. Imagine that as a Liverpool fan. Absolutely gutted. Do not leave before the end.
Keep these coming in. 85058, or you can tweet us at BBC5Live. A lot of people's favourite thing on this show is not really me or Scott. quite rightly, it's the kids who've been made to listen to their parents' favourite old records and CDs and then come on and review them for us.
Agree. Who'd have thought this would be such a hit? Here's just a few reasons why you love them so much. It's time for Kids Review Their Parents' Record Collection. 8-year-old Libby is reviewing her mum's record collection on 5 Live this morning. She's been telling us about Meatloaf's 1977 classic, Bat Out of Hell. So, Libby, your favourite song, please?
Paradise by the Dashboard Light.
And why do you like that one?
It's a very strong song, and I like it because it gets better and better on the way. So first of all, it goes slow, then it goes faster and faster and faster, and at the end is my favourite bit. I always sing really loud at that bit.
Can you sing a bit to me now?
Will you make me my wife? Will you take me away? Will you make me my wife? Gotta know right now, before we go any further, do you love me? Will you love me forever? Do you need me? Will you ever need me? Will you make me so happy for the rest of my life? Will you take me away? Will you make me my wife?
That's unreal. Oh, you're amazing. We've got a 9-year-old here, Richie. Richie and Marlo here is reviewing his mum's record collection. He's been listening to Pills, Thrills and Bellyaches by Happy Mondays. Which album from your mum's collection are you going to review for us this morning?
Too Unlimited.
Seriously?
Shania Twain, Come On Over.
Shania Twain?
Yep.
Kenny Rogers, The Gambler.
Rick Astley, Whenever You Need Somebody.
Green Medelica.
And who's that by?
Primal Scream.
The Fat of the Land.
And who's that by?
Prodigy.
I'm the trouble starter. Punky meets the gator.
What did you think when you first played it?
Angry, aggressive, very scary. Illustrated.
Apologies to the people of London for my very dodgy accent.
It's fine. It's all fine.
No one can get to gigs at the moment, Stan. It's the best they'll get at the moment.
Okay. You two ready?
Yeah, we're ready.
UK, are you ready?
UK!
I'm ready.
Okay, you're ready, we're ready, let's go.
I get up when I want, except on Wednesdays when I get rudely awakened by the dustman.
Spotlight. What album are you going to review for us this morning, Toby?
The Best of Chaz and Dave.
What songs are on the album, Violet?
Well, there's Born to Run, Thunder Road. They're all terrible.
Oh, Violet, you can't bear it, can you?
I'm just saying the truth.
I found Madonna's Immaculate Collection.
Oh, good Lord.
There's a bit of tension on this kid's review because I feel that Scott and the child, in this case, Ava, have opposing views on this album. Yeah. It's leaned to quite what feels like a tense atmosphere. What's your fave, Scott?
Like a Prayer is a brilliant record.
Ava, do you like that one?
No.
So, like, Chaz goes rabbit, and then Dave goes rabbit, and then Chaz, Dave, like that. At the end, they're doing different words of the rabbit.
Yes.
And then that just means they have to work even harder for that point.
Let's hear a bit of the end of Rabbit, actually, just to truly appreciate the craft here.
Rabbit, 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 yep, yep, rabbit, yep, 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 rabbit, rabbit, bunny, jabber, rabbit, yep, rabbit, rabbit, bunny, rabbit, jabber, rabbit, rabbit, yep, yep, rabbit, rabbit, bunny, bunny, yep, jabber, rabbit.
Would you agree, Toby, they're musical geniuses?
Yeah.
How do you reckon the Verve could have made this album any better?
By, making it more of a party song, like adding like screaming camel sounds.
Screaming camel sounds.
And it will make it more like party music.
With screaming camel sounds. I mean, we can try this for you right now if you'd like.
Yes, please.
Okay, let's give this a go. We're going to play in a little bit of Verve. Which song in particular do you think should have the screaming camels?
The Drugs Don't Work, because it's kind of a sad, slow song.
Okay, so you want The Drugs Don't Work by The Verve, and to improve it, we'll add some screaming camels. You ready for this?
Yes.
Okay, here we go, everyone.
Now the drugs don't work.
Imogen, do you think that song sounds much better with the screaming camels?
Yeah.
Oh. Scott Mills and Chris Stark on 5 Live.
Saturday morning, best time of the week. Thank you so much for all the messages that we're getting in this morning. They're so sweet. I particularly like this one from Chris. It says, Scott and Chris, I was outraged when your show started. I listened to 5 Live for sport and current affairs. Now there's a couple of Radio 1 numpties spoiling my Saturday mornings. Oh my God, I was so wrong. I've loved the show and will miss it. It's been such fun. Best wishes. Thank you so much, Chris. I like the honesty of it because I get that. Also, it was weird for us. We were starting on 5 Live. We were new and bringing in a new and different type of show. And it's taken time for us to adjust as massively. Well. But I feel like we've all grown together and that's cool. Good morning, Millie, who's flying back from Sicily. Says she's very, very sad. We saw her through lockdown and some downtimes, and we've been joining her while she drives a minibus of children with special needs every other Saturday. And she goes and says she'll miss us. Thank you so much, Millie. That's so kind.
Thank you. Ollie in Bath says, just some very kind words about the show, really. Thanks, Ollie. Yes, I will pass on your regards to Nigel Owens. And if you want to hear the world's greatest rugby referee sing, you need to keep listening. He promised, and we've kept him to it. Also, good morning, Nikki, who says, wishing you a wonderful last show. Thank you for all the beautiful nonsense that have started my Saturdays for the last few years. By the way, I've one bar of signal in a field in Anglesey, so I'm listening on AM. Please speak loudly. Get in touch. 850-58.
Robbie Williams is coming up, but first, let's get our minds blown. Who's on line one?
Hi, this is Emily, and I'm going to blow your mind for an Italian-style chicken feast pizza.
Italian-style chicken feast, I'm writing it down. This is the part of the show where we buy you a pizza if you blow our minds with an incredible fact. Emily, tell us something fascinating about you that isn't for the pizza.
So, after 9 long years, I've just got engaged.
Yeah!
So my now fiancé finally popped the question a few weeks ago in Greece, and I haven't wasted any time since. I have pretty much booked and organised everything for our wedding next year.
That's what happened to me. When I got engaged, I proposed to my now wife. It was almost immediate. It was the next day. Things moved, it felt like plans were in place very quickly.
You wasted no time, did you, Emily?
Nope, I booked the venue within about 3 days. Amazing. And we were still in Greece.
Nice. I love it.
Nice.
That's organisation. Right, yes. So our cards are out. It's a simple question.
Yeah, who would you like to buy the pizza, Emily? Me or Scott Mills?
I think it will have to be Scott.
Good, okay, let's do that. Good luck. Off you go. Blow our minds.
So, there's a mountain in Australia named Mount Disappointment. It's called that because the explorers were really unimpressed with the view at the top, as when they climbed it, they saw trees preventing the view. The explorer also hurt his groin whilst climbing, so overall it was a rubbish experience. They named it after being disappointed.
Mount Disappointment. Where is it again?
In Australia.
I love that.
That's so good.
It's so Aussie as well.
Yeah.
Is your mind blown?
My mind's blown, I just love that a place can be named after a negative emotion.
Yes. Emily, that's a good fact. Enjoy your wedding when it happens. An Italian-style chicken feast pizza is coming your way later today, hot and fresh from the kitchen.
Should we do one more?
Yeah, let's do one more.
Who is on line two?
Hi, this is Charlie, and I'm going to blow your mind for a mighty meaty.
Oh, okay. Great. Mighty meaty.
Tell us something incredible about you, Charlie. Not just for pizza, just tell us about you.
Really random, but the Stone Roses came to a bar that I was working in, and I was so overwhelmed that I accidentally curtsied them.
I think I've done that before. Wait, you don't really know what to do.
Bow.
You're not sure? Yeah, it's a small bow.
They were blocking the way to the toilets, and I asked if I could get past, and then they were like, yeah, of course, and then I curtsied, which made it even worse.
But then a handshake would have been weirder. Do you know what I mean? I think out of everything you've done, although it is a bit odd, I understand why you did it.
Yeah.
Oh, well, that's good then. I don't feel so bad now.
No, you just kind of take yourself by surprise. Like, oh, God, I just curtsied.
Right, they'll never forget it.
Who do you want to pay for this pizza for the Mighty Meaty, me or Chris Stark?
I think it's only fair that Chris does it.
Okay, one each.
Cool. All right, good luck, Charlie. Blow our minds for pizza.
My mind-blowing fact is Viagra has been shown to revive drooping flowers and make them stand up straight.
I'm going to need a bucket load of that stuff then. So, because I went to Devon for a bit, the flowers are like, we've got some nice flowers.
Right.
But it's been very hot out there.
Hasn't it?
Hasn't it? So all dried up. And you're telling me I just sprinkle Viagra on them and that's surely not true.
Yeah, that's all you have to do. I mean, it,
really?
It works for other things, but it's good that it works for flowers too.
Man, you never see that with Titchmarsh on TV, do you? You never see that. You never see that being the advice, no. Which is extraordinary, really, if it's true.
Right. So, Viagra can prevent droopy flowers. I'm sorry, my mind's absolutely blown.
No, it's nonsense. It can't be real.
Right.
It can't be real.
I think we should all Google it immediately. Charlie, we are sending you a mighty meaty, very well deserved.
Thank you.
Saturday morning with Scott and Chris. Let's bring on the guest. I lost my place in life. He was on one of our first ever shows on 5 Live, and now he's on the last. We've gone full circle. Robbie Williams, your legend, hello.
Hi, guys. How are you both feeling about it being the last one?
I mean, it would be very easy to get very deep and meaningful. It's just a lot of last things at the moment. Last shows on Radio 1 next week.
A lot of lasts.
Wow. So I'm finding the best way to do it is just sort of attack it with positivity and then try and regret nothing.
Well, I'm honoured that I was there first and now I'm here last. Thank you for having
indeed. Me. Yes, indeed. Are you in Ibiza at the moment?
I'm in Ibiza at a friend's villa. You just catch me getting out of the pool with my children.
Robbie, what's this about you DJing now as well? So I saw some stuff go up on socials.
Yeah.
You've been doing gigs out in Ibiza. I think it was Pikes, Ibiza Rocks.
It looks great. Yeah. I did. It's just reconnaissance. I'm in a EDM outfit called Lufthaus, and it's something that was born during COVID. And now we are doing our first gigs, but it's kind of like reconnaissance to find out what it is that I need to be when I'm doing these things. And I thought that it was just going to be me playing some records and then people dancing around and sort of enjoying the vibe, hopefully. As it happens, the first gig was 2,000 people stood still looking at me. And I didn't realize how awkward that is when you
It really is.
It is, isn't it, Scott?
It's really awkward. It really I think 90% of DJing as well is just looking busy.
It is.
And it's what you see with Swedish House Mafia. I mean, there's three of them pressing one button.
No shade.
No, no, they're brilliant, brilliant producers. But what I'm saying is when it comes to DJing,
it's overstaffed.
I was like, this is so awkward. There's only so much, you know, hand pumping and smiling you can do.
That's right.
And then I was just like, lads, show me which channel isn't open and I'll just pretend to move some.
Yeah, you got
right.
it. You got
actually,
it.
Right. You're doing exactly the right thing. All the knobs that don't actually do anything, just twiddle those for an hour and you look like a master.
And then I looked on my Mac like I was busy doing something for the show. Right. But what I was actually Googling was, what do garage MCs say?
Yeah.
And then I Googled that and I was like, inside, this one's for the ladies. And then I just repeated what it said on the screen.
Did you enjoy the DJ gigs?
I was just expecting it to be like a busman's holiday. I didn't expect to have to entertain people. Now I realize that I have to entertain people. I will devise a set where I can, you know, do call and response and get the audience involved. Because, you know, standing there smiling, you can only do that for a couple of songs.
And well, that's DJing with Robbie Williams.
That's DJing, full stop. Last time I saw you was the launch of your album, which is out September the 9th. Tell us about it.
September the 9th is the launch of my album, 25. It's my 25th anniversary as a solo artist since leaving Take That. And it's my greatest hits mixed and rethought with a beautiful orchestra.
And there are a lot, aren't there, Rob?
There's more than two, contrary to people's popular belief.
I do other
songs other than Angels and Maybe Feel.
Is Millennium on the album? I know that's one of your favourites.
Yeah, it's one of my all-time classic favourites.
Yeah,
I don't know, is it on the album, Michael? I'm asking my man.
It is.
I can confirm that Millennium is on the album. That's how much I love that song.
I don't know why you're such a, I wouldn't say a hater of it, but I know it's not your favourite of your songs, is it?
Do you know what? I've got to get into it because, I don't think universally, especially people that dig what I do, I don't think universally people share the same thought as I do about that song. I think it's a great song. We've got stars directing our fate. Have we though? And we're praying it's not too late. Are we? And we know we're falling
into grace.
Yeah, I think I am. I just must have hit some traumatic event on stage while singing it. And I just think it's floppy.
There's quite a few things that we would like to wrap up once and for all on this, our last show. So many talking points that we've got through over the last couple of years, and we'd like to wrap them up once and for all. Let's go. First person you ever fancied, real life and celebrity.
Linda Carter, Wonder Woman. And real life, I would say a girl in the year above me called Lisa Parks.
You're going to have a lot of these, so tell me the first one that comes to mind. Most impulsive thing you've ever done.
I once bought 5 cars all in one go, and then they came to my house and they arrived on the forecourt, and I felt really sad. In my head, I just went, why did I do that? And then I sold them.
The same day?
No, not the same day, but like I instantly was just like, there's no need for this, especially seeing as I haven't got a driver's license.
Yeah, I remember that when I visited you in LA. I was like, because you very kindly said I could borrow your car, and I did. And I know that I did get a couple of speeding fines, which I'm glad to say you paid for me, and I always will appreciate that.
No problem.
And I did curb a vintage Jaguar. But I was surprised to learn when I saw the cars in your garage, you don't actually have a license.
Weirdly, that E-Type Jaguar set itself on fire just after you'd gone.
True story.
Yeah, that E-Type Jaguar now doesn't exist because it's just a burnt out husk.
I feel it was something to do with me. I didn't smoke in there, I promise.
It's all good. All good.
First holiday away from your parents.
First holiday away from my parents was a package holiday with me and Mark Owen to Tenerife. And we were given £500 by our then manager to go away on holiday. And that £500 got us a week away and our spending money. I'd say barely 17. That was the first holiday away.
Did you have to share rooms with Owen?
I had to share a room with Mark Owen, and then on the final couple of nights, we ended up working in a bar.
This is while you were in Take That?
Just on the precipice of international stardom, yes.
Ah, so why did you work in a bar? To get some more money to spend?
No, because we thought it'd be a laugh. We actually didn't get paid. We just did it because we fancied doing it and it'd be fun.
And was it fun?
Yeah, it was. Yeah.
Are you telling me that there was a period in time where two of the biggest pop stars in the world were working in a bar in Tenerife just for the crack?
For no money.
Absolutely. True story.
Right. Robbie Williams, you've got form on this, not necessarily with me, but I know that you do make up things for interviews just because to make them more interesting for yourself. Is that made up?
Ask Mark Owen. Like Joni Mitchell, Mark Owen never lies.
Okay, final one. The time you didn't recognise a celebrity.
The time that I didn't... Oh, yeah. So I was with a group of friends on holiday in Tahiti, and another group of friends arrived, and we were introducing ourselves to everybody, and it was like, "Hi, I'm John, and I'm Rob, and hi, I'm Steve. Hi, Steve. Hi, I'm Barbara. Hello, Barbara. Pleased to meet you. Nice old lady." And then I sat down next to Barbara, and it was Barbara Streisand, and I was like, oh.
Did she know that you didn't know?
No. And then she turns out she actually thought that I was a football player.
Oh, so she didn't know who you were?
No, she didn't know who I was, because people were talking about Soccer Aid, and she just presumed that I played football. And then I was like, oh, no, I'm a singer. And she was like, that's nice.
I feel better that she didn't know you as well, though, you know?
Yeah.
Robbie Williams, it's so good to have you back on. Go get the album September the 9th, XXV. And thank you for taking some time out of your holiday in Ibiza. We really appreciate it.
Thank you very much for having me, lads. And go forth and win. I lost my place in life. I lost my point of view. I lost what it is to love. When I lost my faith in you, I lost.
That is Lost, the new single by Robbie Williams, album out in September. I love that he just interrupted his holiday for us.
Yeah.
What a guy. Legend.
Go forth and win. I love that. That's going to stick with me all weekend now. Go forth and win, Scott Mills. He gets weirdly deep when he wants to, doesn't he?
Really does.
Yeah, he's cool. Listen, have we heard from Leah in Fiji yet? I'm wondering if you've personally heard anything, because I'm scouring the DMs.
My old pen pal.
Your old pen pal. So in case you haven't heard this yet, we've only got about an hour to go. We're trying to track down Scott's old pen pal, Leah in Fiji. He only mentioned this about half an hour ago, and it's the last show. So really, we have until 11 to find her. For an amazing radio moment.
Yeah, I've just been told by the team in my ear that there has been no correspondence so far from Leah. So we've got just over an hour left. Mm. It would be amazing, though, if she did get in touch.
Sort of need it, yeah. The climax
kind
of the show.
Of do. No pressure. Although unlikely.
Saturday morning on 5 Live. So, busy weekend of sport. Chappers will have all the action from midday. More live Premier League commentaries. Everton against Nottingham Forest at 3. Bournemouth play Arsenal at 5:30. And we'll have Leeds against Chelsea and Newcastle against Man City.
Good morning to Katie and Emily from London, who say, love your show so much. We're listening from Valencia in Spain. We've been on holiday since Thursday, but we were not going to miss your last show.
Oh, wow.
Love you both. Always listen to the show in the gym on a Saturday morning. Best of luck to the both of you in the future. Thanks, Katie and Emily. That's so cute. Thank you. Hannah's been on. She says, a couple of weeks ago, Nigel Owens promised to sing on the final show. Is he going to be doing that today? Yes, Hannah, exciting news. Yes, he will. Before 11 o'clock today, rugby referee legend Nigel Owens will be singing Frank Sinatra. He promised, and he's doing it.
We've been talking about the most impulsive things that you've done, and I think agreeing to that was potentially Nigel's.
Definitely. It's Scott and Chris on 5 Live. This morning on the show, the most impulsive thing you've ever done. Good morning, Danny.
Good morning.
What have you got for us?
Right, well, back in 2008, I was on a round the world trip and was in Hawaii, and I was getting a little bit frustrated with my travel buddy and another girl that we sort of palled up with as well, who sort of changed her route and joined us. And we were in Oahu, and I got so annoyed I just thought I need to get out of here. And I thought beyond changing hotels or anything like that. And I went online and I booked a flight. And the next day I got on that flight and I flew to another island called Maui and spent a week there on my own. It was fantastic. But when I flew back to Oahu, because we were then traveling on to LA, nothing was mentioned. I just turned up back at the airport for the next connecting flight. And they just said, all right. And I said, yep. And we carried on.
Did you tell your friends you were leaving them?
I'm trying to think back. I think I said something like, I'm going to go elsewhere. But I think they probably thought that meant, you know, to the beach or something. not another island.
It feels like something I might do.
You have done it to a lesser extent. Wasn't there that time you did a big night out with another radio presenter and ended up in Amsterdam?
There was that time.
My experience of Scott over the years has been, in terms of being impulsive, is that he will often just decide to leave wherever you are, and then you'll get a text just saying, you know, some sort of withering excuse followed by a few kisses.
Yeah. Yes.
That
yes,
he's basically, do that. He's decided to go and do something else. And some would call it rude.
Well, it's how I've earned the nickname Houdini with some of my friends, because I will just literally go. It's the Gloria Gaynor principle. Never can say goodbye.
Yeah.
Do you let him get away with it, though, Chris? Do you let him get away with it? Do you give him a hard time?
What can you do? Because I'm lucky at least that I get a message from Scott, and you know, other people get a message from the agent just saying sorry. It'll be like, if you hear, I'm just putting this out there to anyone That's listening to this. I know there's a lot of colleagues that listen to this as well. If you get a message saying I had to leave for a voiceover. Yeah. He's lying to you. Voiceovers don't really happen anymore. It's an easy excuse for a radio presenter. And actually, in Scott's life, he's got now more excuses he can hide behind with both a fiance and a dog.
Yes, exactly.
Any of those, it's a lie.
The best thing I ever got was my dog, because it's such a good excuse.
As a producer of the show has just reminded me as well, what voiceover happens at 9:30 p.m. is utter
That's
nonsense.
A good point.
It's the go-to excuse. And it's terrible, actually, because it's both a lie, but also makes him look like he's really in demand as well. It's staggering.
Danny, thank you so much for being on the show.
Oh, thank you so much for the fab 3 years on 5 Live. It's been amazing. Some great segments. Really enjoyed it all.
You've got great segments.
You have.
Thank you.
Thank you for them.
Thank you for all your stories this morning and piling in all the various topics over the last couple of years.
There's been so many.
Strange ones, some good ones, some ones. That's fine. And we're getting loads of stories from you guys about the time you left somewhere early. Some shockers here. Someone whose number ends in 014 says, about leaving football early, I once went to see a Norwich away game at Burnley. It was a frantic finish. We scored 2 goals in injury time to get a 4-4 draw. Got onto our coach to find 4 fellow Norwich fans who had missed it all because they left early to avoid the rush at an away game. So think about it, Scott. It's not even like they've gone to beat the traffic. They've just left the stand to go sit in a bus.
Yeah.
So I think what's happened is they've stormed out because angry. I'm really, really angry at this. I'm not putting up with this. Has left sort of processing and gone outside and gone, nowhere to go.
Yeah.
But you've not experienced this. You've never done an away day at the football, have you?
I haven't.
See, I would love you to do that. I'd love you to do the full coach experience, you know, get on the bus.
And I need to apologise now, because I did let you down this week.
You did. I invited you to Watford, Birmingham away. We had a gig in Birmingham, which, the stars aligned wonderfully. We could have gone there, enjoyed the game, gone and DJed afterwards, and you let me down. We've just been talking about it. Another excuse, wasn't it?
I've got a dog.
See, it's always the dog now. You always blame the dog, and it's unfair on Teddy.
It's a better excuse than a voiceover, isn't it?
You bought a dog just to have a convenient excuse. That's what it feels like.
Right, I'll level with you now. I know that throughout our 10 years more of friendship, I've never been to a Watford game with you, but before Thursday, when we leave Radio 1...
You'll go to one?
I don't know if there's one in time, but I will make a solemn promise to you.
Thank you.
Okay?
Mila Kunis said the same. Never happened.
Are you dancing?
Are you asking?
It's the second half of The Last Dance. As James Gregg just said, good morning. It's Scott Mills and Chris Stark till 11.
Miss him as well, by the way. He's funny.
He's very
funny.
Does
us these little intros, which I don't think you're really meant to do on the news, but he's like, he really bigs us up.
He does what he wants.
He does what he wants. Respect him for it.
Send us a text, 85058, or you can tweet us at BBC5Live.
We've been talking about bands' encores. Andy in Doncaster went to see his favourite band, Crowded House, recently. Now, Andy admits he'd had a bit to drink. He says, when the band said, thank you and good night, everyone started to leave. I shouted at the crowd something like, get back, you idiots, there'll be an encore. I found out shortly after the band had already been off stage once, but I'd failed to notice because I was at the bar buying more lager.
Well done.
Tricky, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's when you think you're in the right. Yeah, especially late at night, maybe after a couple of drinks, you have that sort of confidence in yourself that you really shouldn't have. It's an unfortunate byproduct.
Good morning to Tim, who says, I didn't know you guys were on Saturdays.
Welcome along. Tim. Tell your friends.
You can get the Scott Mills and Chris Stark podcast. They'll still be available on BBC Sounds. But Tim, welcome to our last show on 5 Live.
Where have you been?
He says, so you don't do Fridays, but you do Saturdays. We do Saturdays. And I'm glad you've just noticed. Coming up, we'll play the Upside Down Quiz with Stacey Dooley and the final Real Life TMO with Nigel Owens, refereeing your arguments and dilemmas. Right, I'm told there is now someone I know on the line. Hello?
Hi, it's Lauren from Fiji.
It's not, because her name was Leah.
Did you just say Lauren from Fiji or Leah from Fiji?
No, I said Leah from Fiji.
Right.
Leah from Fiji, Scott. Your old pen pal, we maybe have tracked her down here. If you were listening an hour ago, we found out Scott had a pen pal when he was 10 called Leah, not Lauren,
no,
who lives in Fiji.
I think they messed it up, whoever it is.
We asked her to get in touch. Here she is.
Sure.
So when was the last time you got a pen pal letter from Scott, Leah?
About 30 years ago. Who is this, please, to be honest?
Yeah. Who is it?
It's Maisie Adam. I'm really sorry.
There we go. I didn't believe
I'll be honest, I didn't do it well there, did
it
I?
It wasn't the best, Maisie, but it's all good. I've resigned myself to the fact that I'll probably never hear from Leah again.
Well, we're still 50
minutes. Don't give up.
We've had a few texts from people claiming to be your pen pal, but then it's interesting because you look at the other texts they've sent in.
Well, that's the thing, we can see what people don't know is we can see your previous text. So here's one. Hello, it's Leah from Fiji, I'm listening. I know that your name is Dave because I've seen your previous text, Dave. But thanks for your input.
Yeah, and we've seen your views on various topics.
Very stop, angry sometimes, Dave.
Stop pretending to be Leah.
Especially in the mornings. Maisie, how are you?
I'm very well, thank you. How are you two? Final day.
Yeah, I know. So there's a lot of finals at the moment. You're in Edinburgh, I presume, like the rest of the comedy world.
Yes, yeah, it's quite a bubble, I won't lie.
Do you get, I was talking to Jade Adams about this, after it's all over, do you get slight Edinburgh blues? Or are you like, thank God that's over?
Oh no, I've not got the blues, I'm straight out there, back into normality. I feel like, do you remember, you know, the beginning of that, this is quite a Who reference here, but you know the T.I. and Justin Timberlake video where they come out of that prison and they're on the road? That's how I feel when I come out of Edinburgh.
What a reference.
What an image.
Quite niche, but I enjoy it.
Do you get like, how many shows are you doing a day? Can you get like a sort of show fatigue? Like, because
are you over it?
I mustn't say I'm over it. I'm very much still enjoying it and raring to go.
Mm-hmm.
I'm doing the show every day though, and then on top of that you're doing all of these like other spots, and also like now I'm doing extra shows because we sold out the run, so it's quite tricky when you get to show number two because you're thinking, oh my God, have I already said this? And you have, just in a different show.
You know, at festivals, right, there's this big thing of like artists come out. I think they do it because it's great for their ego and attention.
Yeah.
Case in point, Chris Martin from Coldplay loves to just come out on someone else's set.
Oh, he loves it.
You know, and lap up the glory. Drake's another one.
Same.
Have you spotted either of those at the Edinburgh Fringe? And has anyone threatened to do the same with you?
This fringe, I had it threatened by Josh Widdicombe and Nish Kumar. I said, absolutely not. You're not crashing. My first Edinburgh, Joel Dommett asked if he could come in. He was doing this thing for like Stand Up to Cancer, where he went into all of these different shows and did 5 minutes at each other's show. And I was really new, and I was like, oh, to have Joel there, that's great. Mm. Sort of publicity. And actually, it sort of massively backfired, really, because everybody was like, oh my God, Joel Dommett off the telly. And then he left, and then I had to go on and do my hour.
That's nothing against you, but I often think this is the case. When Chris Martin turns up, it's lovely for 5 minutes that he's there, but no one gives any thought to what happens afterwards. It's just a major kind of disappointment.
I'll just carry on then.
It's like, oh, should we get back to it?
Oh, God. So, do you think I'm the Chris Martin of comedy?
No,
because you're not interrupting other people. I think that would be Josh Widdicombe in your case.
he's the Chris Martin of comedy, 100%.
Yes, he is. So what's your show called? And you've put an extra date on because you're so popular. As you said, the whole run is sold out.
Oh, guys, it's mad. So the show's called Buzzed. We've been selling out every day, and we've now sold out the rest of the run.
Yes.
So what they've done is they've put me in this massive room for an extra show for one day. And it's absolutely massive, guys. It's 350 seaters. I'm bricking it. But it's too big. I don't know what they've done. It's too big.
Right. And what's it called? The room?
The show's called Buzzed. Oh, the room is called the Debating Hall.
Oh.
Because it's proper Hogwarts vibes because it's part of the Edinburgh unit. It's mad. It's mad.
So when's the Debating Hall show?
On Tuesday, the 23rd at 3:30.
Right, well, you need to get shifting them tickets, don't you?
Yeah, I do. Bring yourself, bring every relative, bring all plus ones are definitely invited.
Plus fours.
Yeah. Yes, please.
Plus 300.
Amazing. I'm so pleased you're on our last show. You obviously have been on a couple of times presenting it as well.
Yes, very good fun. Thank you.
Which has been wonderful. We're just wrapping up some of the talking points that we've been doing whilst we've been on. So let's try one with you. First person you fancied. We need an answer which is both real life and celebrity.
And famous, yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, the celebrity one was Danny Zuko in Greece. 100% straight away.
You know,
that bit when he turns around at the beginning of the film and he's, oh God, I'm thinking about it now. He's got this, and he's got that dimple in the chin.
I was going to say, it is the chin that did it for you, isn't it?
Oh, it was lovely. It was like, this is so bad. I've never told anybody this, but I used to, when I was a kid, like try and nip my chin together to see if I could give myself one. And thought if I did it for half an hour every night, I'd get one too.
Well, so you did that for half an hour every night just to try and get the Zuko
chin?
Yeah,
get into bed and like sort of grip my chin into two bits.
And real life?
Real life. Well, it was literally the lad who lived next door. He was called Daniel and he had very like blonde sandy hair.
Did he?
I would have been like 5 and he was like maybe coming back from university and he had a moped and I thought it was the coolest thing ever.
Amazing. Moped at the age of 5.
We love you. And
I was 5. They were like coming back to music.
Scott, super quickly, did you know Maisie once saw us in Zante with DJ and she queued up to have a photo with us?
No apparently. Way.
Yeah.
Yeah, at Club Zero.
Yes, at Zero's.
I'm mad at that.
That is mad. Go and see Maisie Adam in Edinburgh, please, on Tuesday. It's your last chance to see her at the Fringe. Thanks, Maisie.
Cheers, guys. Have a great rest of your show.
Good morning, Duncan.
Hiya.
What's the most impulsive thing you've ever done?
Okay, so this is a few years ago now. I had a very good friend of mine, and we were living together next to her for a while, and then she moved away. And then one day on a Sunday night, around about 6 o'clock in the night, she phoned me up and she says, well, I decided to go travelling around the world. Would you like to come with me? And I need an answer by tomorrow morning.
Wow.
So at the time, I had a job. I was living in a house down there. I had a few possessions, and so I went out that night, and I was actually on a date with another girl. And I explained to her, I said, I've been offered the chance to go travel around the world, and she looked at me and amusement, and then started talking about a cat for a couple of hours. And I thought at the end of it, I thought, I think this might be a good idea to go traveling around the world. So I actually ran the next morning, and then we agreed to go traveling. So she turned up the following Saturday. I handed him a notice in the following day for my job. And
what? Sorry, Duncan, why the rush with this? Like, it's so bizarre. Like, going around the world's quite a big deal. Quitting your job's quite a big deal, and you seem to have done it all in the space of a day.
Yeah,
two.
But I love the impulsiveness of it.
It just seemed a really good idea at the time. I had no reason not to. I had no real ties. She'd obviously been thinking about it for some time. So she had been thinking about it for some time. And she'd made a decision that weekend that was the weekend that she wanted to go for it. So she was handing her notes in the next day. She was going to go traveling on her own. She wanted to know whether I'd be prepared to join her. So I said, yeah, I'll have a go at that. So 3 weeks later, I remember packing up all my stuff. Anything I could carry my rucksack, I took off around the world with me. The rest of it, I just sold the few possessions I had, which was a bed and a television, really, to some friends down in Exeter. We ended up going around the world for 10, 11 months, came back, and that was 24 years ago. Since then, we went as friends. We've come back, we got married. We had our 24th anniversary this week. And my two children, who are 22 and 20, are currently together, travelling through Central America.
I love it. It's on my bucket list, you know, before I go, to just turn up at the airport one day and then decide where to go. I would love to do that.
I'm not really that bothered about seeing the world.
No, you're actually not, are you? As you've said before, what can other places in the world offer you that Devon can't?
I tell you, I really stand by that.
You stick by it, don't you?
Yeah.
South America wouldn't be for Chris, Dunk.
Well, when I was over there, we saw, and this one might be for Chris, we'd only been there a week, we were in a place called Mendoza, and it was a day of the Argentinian FA Cup final equivalent between River Plate and Boca Juniors.
That is, to be fair, that is cool.
Wow. Yeah.
But the next day, I was in the square at Mendoza, and sitting next to, I found a bench, and I was sitting next to two deserters from the Swiss Army, actually. And as we were the only people there, it was the middle of siesta, and Diego Maradona walked straight past with two other players from Boca Juniors.
What?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Because he'd been playing the night before.
Pull that out of your pocket. This is crazy.
Duncan, thank you so much for being on the show this morning. Just drop that in at the end.
Mad. It's Real Life TMO soon. We should get Nigel Owens to decide on which is best, South America or Devon.
Yeah.
I think it's an easy one, really.
It's Saturday morning Devon. On Five Live.
Wait.
No, I know you always
Five think, Live.
Yeah, I know you think it's Devon. Fighting Talk with Colin at 11 o'clock. So, shall we announce the new Saturday morning host?
Yeah.
We have had a brilliant time doing this show for the last 3 years. Brilliant. But even though our time is up, you will not miss us because there is a fantastic new presenter of this show starting in 2 weeks' time. And I'm so happy it's them.
Yeah, same. This is really exciting.
So should we announce?
Let's do it to the song.
Right, where we would normally go Five Live. Okay, here we go. It's coming up. Here we go. Patrick Hilty.
Just to confirm.
It's Patrick Hilty.
Yes.
That's right.
What a guy.
One more time. Patrick Hilty. Patrick Hilty is your new friend on Saturday mornings. Paddy is a lovely guy, and you are going to love spending time with him every weekend. It's Scott and Chris till 11.
Do you know, there's so many messages that we're getting in from people that sort of enjoy the stuff we do, and it's nice, and it's friendly, and it's happy. And Patrick Hilty is exactly that guy as well. You're going to love him.
Right. He is the greatest rugby referee in the world. It's time to go to TMO one last time. Refereeing your minor disputes and dilemmas, bring on Nigel Owens. It's the world in good again. The world has won as we climb to reach our destiny. Oh, no age has begun. Real Life TMO. Good morning, Sir Nigel Owens.
Well, good morning and bore da to you both.
Bore da, Nigel. Just quickly, before we start here, a message from Adam in Kent. He says, I never used to like Nigel Owens, Mainly because the bloke in my... It's a good start, isn't it? Mainly because the bloke in my school who stole my first girlfriend was also called Nigel Owens. Couldn't stand the fella. However, I have loved Nigel's appearances on your show over the years, and it's helped me get over that betrayal. But just to put my mind at rest, Nigel, it wasn't you who dated a girl called Joanne Sanderson around 1994, was it?
There is no danger of me stealing a girlfriend. No danger at all. So it definitely wasn't me.
But why?
The last smooch I had was with a girl in Manicaddick Disco when I was about 15 years of age.
It's a good alibi, Nigel, and I believe you. And it's great to know that your appearances on this show have helped Adam get over it.
It is good to hear, isn't it? It's not just sorting out people's sort of disputes. It's actually helping him get over the loss of his first girlfriend.
Nigel Owens is not just the world's greatest rugby referee. He also referees your personal disputes on this show. Nigel, it's time for some final closure. You ready?
Yes, let's give it a go.
We got this email from Olivia in York. She says, I'm going on holiday to Greece with my best friend Lucy soon. However, Lucy insists on taking the entire contents of her kitchen cupboards on holiday as she likes her home comforts. She'll end up taking British crisps, biscuits, tea bags, even noodles. She fills her suitcase with the stuff. I'm trying to persuade her just to enjoy the foreign experience. What's the point of going somewhere else otherwise? Please tell her to leave the hobnobs at home for once, Sir Nigel. Nigel, over to you.
Oh, now then, I let you into a secret here. Every time I went away to referee, no matter where in the world I would go to, I would always take Welsh tea bags with me because, I don't know, wherever you go in the world, the tea never tastes the same as it is at home here. So I've always taken tea bags with me. No matter where in the world I am, I always have my tea bags with me. And I have been known as well to take a couple of rich tea or Marie biscuits with me as well on occasion. So I'm afraid as long as she's sensible and she does try a bit of the food in Greece as well, then no, I'd be all for sorry packing a few home comforts to take with me, I'm afraid. I've done it myself. Wouldn't go anywhere without my Welsh tea.
On that front as well, we had a situation as a family where we'd go to the same place on holiday pretty much every year. But my dad, as you know, is a very thorough guy, but he likes his food quite simple. But with like if we're doing chicken on the barbecue, he loves his herbs. Now, the problem is he decanted the herbs into a small plastic bag. And
oh, no.
it was just mixed herbs, I can assure you. Oregano, thyme, you know. But a word of warning to everyone when packing for holiday, you know, be careful on that front. Because when they pull the bag out, it's hard to explain.
Ron must have been in there hours explaining that one away.
He didn't receive the gloved hand.
No, but he was detained, I imagine.
But I don't think it ever got that bad, but I just always remember Dad's herbs in a bag, you know? And there were herbs.
I was going out to to referee in France, and sometimes when you fly with certain airlines, they're pretty much renowned for not being the best at your luggage arriving there. So we're advised to take your essentials with you, your boots, your shorts, your jersey, and obviously your whistle and stuff in your hand luggage. And so at least if your luggage didn't arrive, you'll have your kit to referee the game in. And I was flying from Bristol Airport and going through the customs, and they wouldn't allow me to take my whistle. They said it could be deemed as a dangerous object on the plane. I don't know.
That's not on the sign. They don't. It's not gas filming. Canisters,
there's
knives,
no,
guns.
There's no whistles on the sign.
I was filming. I've had the same whistle since I started at 16 years of age.
You can't take a plane down with a whistle. Advocating trying here, but it what a ludicrous idea.
Well, the reason the person said to me was the fact that if you blew the whistle, it could be a signal for other people to try and sort of overrun the plane type of thing, you know. Which I thought,
if Nigel Owens, please, this is no, stop. This is one of your finest.
I was no lack of common sense. Three referees from West Wales I'm going to overrun a plane with a whistle.
Oh, bless. Like, at least they've been careful.
So should Olivia's friend Lucy stop taking all her favourite British food and drink on holiday?
No, don't stop taking it. You take it with you, but in moderation, and do sample some of the food in Greece as well, as I'm sure it is lovely. No, I've never been to Greece.
Decision given. Finally, Jay in Worthing has been on. Jay says, when we go out for a meal, my family always find it hard to decide whether to have a starter or a dessert. So, if you have to choose between the two, which is best, Nigel? Sweet or savoury? Over to you.
Oh, Jay, I tell you one thing, this is a bit dilemma I have sometimes myself. I do like pudding, I have to say, a little bit of chocolate or a little biscuit, but I do prefer that usually in the night after a sit down, a couple of hours before going to bed with a cup of tea. But and when I do go out, I am a big fan of my starters, I have to say. So
yeah.
If I do tend to leave one course out, it will be the dessert. I do eat dessert as well, but on most occasions, I find myself having a starter and a main. And you know, sometimes, I sometimes enjoy the starter more than actually the main meal sometimes. Definitely starter and main for me, for sure.
You've never been tempted to go starter, main, ask for the menu back and hit them with another starter?
No, but I haven't done that. But tell you what I have done. Instead of having a main meal, I've had a starter twice.
So oh, mate, well, that's tapas. Welcome to tapas.
Yeah, welcome along.
Tapas is just a series of small starters.
Yeah,
you don't really have
it
in Wales so much.
No.
But it's a Spanish thing, really. And, yeah, give that a whirl. But there's not really a tapas of puddings, is there? You don't get a sort of pudding tapas.
So we need a decision here for Jay in Worthing. Which is best to get, a starter or a pudding?
Oh, Jay, a starter for me.
Decision given. And that was TMO. Nigel, it's been emotional.
Oh, what a journey. It's been a pleasure to be on this emotional journeys of highs and sometimes lows.
Sometimes lows.
That people really, really needed a closure on, and it's been draining. Do you know what? I'm looking forward now to having a break because it's been emotionally and physically draining as well, making these big decisions. But thank you for the opportunity. Thank you for the boys. And
well, thank you for coming out of retirement to do it. As well.
I wouldn't come out for retirement for everybody, boys, but I come out of retirement for you anytime.
Yeah, I really like that sentiment, and we should definitely get that, you know, in the press release when the show is gone. It's been draining. It's been draining is a wonderful way to put it, Nigel. You have such a way with words.
So, Nigel Owens, thank you for being our real life TMO. It's the world in good again. The world has won as we climb to reach our destiny. Do you really think you've introduced tapas to the people of Wales?
Come on, you know I'm fishing. It's all good. Such a shame we're on next week. The people of Wales introducing tapas. Now, have you heard of this thing called tapas?
It's so
obviously not. I know it is. You
right.
know it is.
Okay. We are. You said it's a shame we're on.
Sorry,
next
it's
week.
A we're shame not we're on. Not on next week because I'm really keen for people's custom stories now. We've only got half an hour. This is, you know, after my dad and his herbs in a bag.
Well, we love. We
nothing
share
to declare.
We share a love of nothing to declare.
It's always on TV. They seem to have filmed thousands of these things. Like it's just always on.
And one of our friends was on it.
Yeah. Yeah, although I do feel with Nothing to Declare, I figured out a flaw in the plan. Like, if they're pixelated, they're generally guilty, aren't they?
Well.
So it's a bit of a plot spoiler. But yes, you're right, our friend that was on there, and we recognised him, because one, it's quite hard to pixelate a bald person.
Yeah.
And two, the bag.
The bag had the name of the radio station he works at on it.
Yeah.
So it was clear that it was Neil Greenslade. He did nothing wrong.
No, they didn't find anything.
He was taken to one side for quite a long time, but, like, he was on the show.
goals.
Well, let's see what we get in. We haven't got long. Half an hour, literally. And maybe Patrick Kilty can take this up. 85058, awkward encounters at customs, please.
Scott Mills and Chris Stark on Five Live.
It is the best time of the week. Scott Mills and Chris Stark setting up your Saturday morning one last time. At 11, it's fighting talk. Good morning, Colin Murray.
I just hope we can get through this. I really do.
Hold hands.
We get through this. Come on, set us up. Do you know what it's how I would describe what's happening right now. You know, I'm sad, don't get me wrong, right? But it's like, you know when a distant relative dies, you're sad, but then you're also like, what can I take from their house? Who owns the features? Can I have...
It's an interesting one, isn't it?
Well, it is an interesting one. Right. And probably, it's very complicated to go into on air.
Right.
But what would you like?
Well, I just want to put a little dabs. Do you know, like, I like the sofa.
It'll want the kids' review, I reckon.
Dry eye
reckon.
No, that's the sacred horse. You don't go near that. There's no such thing as a sacred horse, sacred cow. I want Real Life TMO. I think it translates really well to late night radio.
It does.
And people ringing up with their problems. Yeah. And I would maybe expand it out a bit that way.
Yeah.
You know, I think I would take it somewhere else. But like, you know, ITV buying Big Brother, right. I think I can reinvent it. So I would like that when you die in 23 minutes from now. So I just want to...
Is this going to be a hostile takeover of that feature, or will there be a discussion about money?
I have to admit to you, Emlyn is really shaking his head right now. It's a definite no for that. I've got your box of tricks here.
What do you mean?
Well, you're not here. Where are you even?
I'm in Belfast, beautiful Belfast today, doing a show from here.
I've got your sound effects box.
Nice. What sound effect would you
say? Have we spoiled the illusion that you'll be in control of it
today? No, I am always in control, but today I'm not. Charlie's going to do it. Charlie's been on the show for so long that we were just like a family, so she can do it. And I'm doing BBC Two stuff over here.
Right.
What sound effect that you have there would sum up today for you two and what you're feeling in your hearts right now?
You do one, I'll do one.
Okay. This one for me. Chris, come and have a go.
Okay.
All the world is waiting.
Oh, yeah, here we go.
That's the one. It's a mic drop song, leaving the building. Glory, increased ratings. Yeah, everyone wishing you well. Yes. That's the song.
Oh, it hits differently this morning, doesn't it?
It's so hard to list what I'm going to miss the most, but I think it'll be like Scott's Sporting Insight. You know, that little thing. I hadn't thought about that, Scott. And I've been covering football for a long time, but... Yeah. I didn't think about that, and you just had that ability to drop that one little bit of analysis in that you knew you weren't going to hear from Shearer, you knew you weren't going to hear from Neville, you know, you certainly weren't going to hear it from a Murray. I'll miss that.
And let's be honest, you didn't have me getting a show on Five Live on your Scott Mills scorecard, did you?
No, absolutely not. I will say this in my one moment of sincerity, thank you. From the minute you came on, you always trailed Fighting Talk and made it feel like part of the mornings, and it really helped us. And I hope whoever's coming in, have you announced who's coming in?
Patrick Kilty.
Yeah, Paddy now has a lot to live up to. So you made it all feel like one family on a Saturday on Five Live, right through into Chappers as well. So we've had that connection all the way through. I'm genuinely, you know, I love this show, so I'm going to miss it so much.
I'm probably going to resent
Paddy a bit for a while.
Yeah, well, happened with the last host.
That's the routine,
host,
isn't it? That's the circle of life.
Yeah.
It is.
I mean, we're getting so many lovely messages this morning. Thank you.
Yeah, yeah. And that definitely
I wish it'd been like this from the start.
Yeah, it wasn't the case at the start.
Nobody likes new things.
Oh, they don't.
Oh, the bile you receive when you start a new show.
I'm about to find out, yeah.
Exactly, right? Mm-hmm. Exactly that. It's always the same. I always wish I took a snapshot of the first day of a radio show and the last day. Our TV's the same. Like the EFL highlights would be an example of that recently, and it's like it is just actually it's not about someone actually being like amazingly better than someone else. It's just we love what we are, you know, becomes company and becomes routine, doesn't it?
Yeah, so it's human nature. I get it. We get it.
Yeah.
But it's been such an honour for us doing these Saturday mornings. Yeah. And before Fighting Talk as well, which genuinely, not just saying it because we're all going to love emotional. It, you know how much I love that. You know how much, I'll be honest with you, I'm going to be really honest here. I really wanted to do Fighting Talk and be on it, but I was too scared. I did it once just so I could say I'd done Fighting Talk.
Yeah.
And then I refused to come on again because I just thought, thank you, Scott, because I just, I didn't want to ruin my memory of being on it.
Right. You've done it once.
I was too chicken.
You've done it once and that's it.
Yeah.
And it's like, you know, you have a really successful first date, but in your head, you're like, I'm not good enough.
And I never got a chance to be on.
You never got, but poor Charlie sent me emails pretty much weekly saying, would you be up for coming on? And there was another excuse that got fired back weekly. The truth was, I was done it once.
And you were rubbish.
I was like, I've ticked that box. Oh, were you any good?
I get that. And you did well. You did well. Ish. I mean, if you score from downtown, you don't want to go back for a free, you know, free point throw. I agree. Scott will have no idea what that just meant, but don't worry about it, Scott.
Literally, I don't know what you're talking about. But listen, we love you. Thank you very much. Who's on
Love you so
talk?
Much. I'll see you Thursday.
Yeah, see you Thursday. Are you
by
coming?
By 3 o'clock. Yeah, I'll get there by 3 o'clock.
Everything's on air now. Good.
Straight off the train. Ugo, Natalie, Kay and Phil are on. That could be any people. So let me say Brown, Curd, Pike and Monya.
Oh,
so there you go.
With last names.
Yeah, that's good. Colin Murray with Fighting Talk.
Love you.
11, I love you. Are you ready to quiz?
Let's quiz!
The Upside Down Quiz. It's like a normal quiz, but our listeners are the quiz masters. They ask the questions, we win their stuff. Today's contestant is a good friend of this show. She's presented it nearly as often as Chris Stark. Please welcome to Five Live, Stacey Dooley.
Hey.
Morning, Stacey. Dun, dun.
Oh, my five. Here they are. How are you both feeling?
Weird. How are you?
You know, I'm spot on. I felt a bit emotional listening to the three of you. I can't believe it's the last day. I truly can't.
Yeah. Thank you so much for being on the last show. Are you looking forward to Patrick Kilty on a Saturday morning?
Well, he's a magnificent broadcaster, isn't he? So I suppose the best is yet to come.
fair enough.
No. But I know, like, I don't want to sound too oversincere, but you two were always such sweethearts to me, like true diamonds. And even when Scott would run out for a quick wee and I'd be panicking, you would always come back just before we went live.
Do you remember
the
way
you
did
always
come
had
back.
My back?
Do you remember
he did always
the first time you did this show? You thought it was like an Anton Deck prank because I literally walked in.
I did.
5 seconds before we were going to go on air. She's like, is this Anton Deck? Is this Anton Deck? But it wasn't. I'll always come back, Stacey. You know it.
Oh, mate. I just felt so clammy because I thought, God, I'm not up to speed at all with the buttons. I don't quite know what I'm doing. That's Scott's territory. But you've always looked after me. And I just think the world of you both. So,
thank you.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, we've been talking about awkward experiences at customs. And I give a full shout out to my friend that was on Nothing to Declare. Nothing was found. You must have had quite a few experiences at customs.
Oh, listen, there's nothing I haven't been put through at customs. I'll tell you one very, very quickly because now we ain't got loads of time. So I was in Honduras and I'd been making a really intense documentary. Anyway, our fixer, she lived in Mexico City. So she flew off to Mexico and I was waiting for the flight to London. Anyway, this is no top up and it sounds like I'm fibbing, but it's completely true. I had two guys, I was in sort of, you know, the departures area and I had two lads tap me on the shoulder. And in Spanish, said to me, you know, my sort of terrible broken Spanish, my understanding was, can you follow us? And they walked me out of the area, down a couple of like really quite dodgy looking corridors, sat me in a room and like just presented me with my bulletproof vest that they found in my luggage. And they were like, can you explain to us why you've got a bulletproof vest in your luggage? Like, what the hell is going on? Where have you been? Who have you been liaising with? And I remember crying because I just thought I can't speak Spanish. My fix is on a flight to Mexico. I'm going to be in a prison in Honduras for the next 5 to 10 years.
Wow.
Mad thing to pack, though, isn't it?
It's
something a bit like, you know, it's like, you know, questions should be asked, perhaps.
Well, quick, where I ballsed it up, I think I took the press. You know, the press is sort of Velcro, so I think that had come off, so I think it was less obvious. Anyway, I live to tell the tale.
Well, we all knew that Stacey Dooley would have a zinger custom story, and there it was. Right, let's meet our quiz master. Good morning, Angela.
Good morning, everybody.
You're right?
Yeah, good, thank you. Yeah, it's really good, yeah.
Right, you've been on before. You're one of our favourite quiz masters, so we're delighted that you're doing the last show. Say hi to Stacey Dooley, please, Angela.
Oh, hi, Stacey. How are
Hello,
you doing today?
Darling. I'm spot on, actually. How are you, Angela?
I'm good, yeah. Gutted it's their last show good. Today, but they're going on to bigger and better things.
We are here.
This is it. Yeah. We've got them, guys. It's like they're dead.
They were beautiful.
Angela, tell us something about you that we don't know.
Okay, so an interesting fact about me is I think I'm a top musical theatre expert, as I volunteer as an usher in the Millennium Centre in Cardiff. And I have seen hundreds of musicals. And at the moment, Lion King is there. And I've seen it about 6 or 7 times in the last couple of weeks. So I could probably go on stage and understudy for somebody now.
Right. So you've seen The Lion King several times in the last few weeks?
Yes, yeah. Yeah, I think about 7 times in the last few weeks. And I'm going again next week to sit in the audience as well.
You should get a season ticket. That, I don't know if they do that in theatres. Good,
no,
good
well,
idea.
Because I actually usher there as a volunteer, I get to see the shows loads of times, which I love.
I love this. I didn't know this. That's amazing. Yeah. Right, what can we win on the quiz today, Angela?
Okay, so my prize is very, very useful in today's economy. I actually grew some tomatoes from seeds that I bought last year, from tomato plants that I bought and ate, and I loved them so much. I kept the seeds, I grew them, and I've now got loads and loads of tomatoes. So I can send whoever wins a pack of homegrown tomato seeds.
Seeds?
Yes.
For the last show.
So you can grow your own.
Is this a joke? I thought the team would have organised a speedboat or a car or
no.
Is it actually seeds?
We can mint.
Yeah, but the thing is, with the cost of living going up at the moment, I think it's a really good prize.
Grow your own.
Angela, yeah. Angela, right. I thought you were going to say, oh, you can have a couple of tickets to the Lion King because they cost a fortune. Yeah. I thought, oh, that'd be great.
No, sorry.
You can't throw them in for us, Angela, no?
No, nothing to do with me. No. But if anyone from Millennium Centre is here, then they may do. You never know.
Awesome. All right. Well, write down your answers. There's a point for each question you get right, and the winner gets Angela's seeds. Let's go for round one, Angela, which is Scott and Chris on 5 Live. Here we go.
Okay. Question one. When Mark Ronson appeared on the show, he revealed that his stepdad wrote a classic power ballad. But which one was it? Was it A, Eric Carmen's All By Myself? B, Foreigner's I Want to Know What Love Is? C, Busted Sleeping With the Lights On?
Genuinely a classic.
Mm. We had Mark Ronson on this show, and he did tell us that his stepdad wrote a massive power ballad, and it was one of those, All By Myself, I Want to Know What Love Is, or Sleeping With the Light On. Stacey Dooley, your answer, please.
I have no idea, Scott. I reckon I'm going to go with I Want to Know What Love Is, because All By Myself, wasn't that Celine Dion?
Yeah, it was Eric Carmen first, though.
Oh, fine, understood.
Celine
was a cover. I'm still going to go...
Eric Carmen.
I'm going to go I Know What Love Is.
Not Eric Cartman.
Say, that's definitely not right.
Oh, bad.
Oh, I can't do the voice. Rubbish.
Oh,
I don't think it's Busted Sleeping With the Lights On, although that is one of my favourite songs of all time. I'm not even joking. It's one of the first two, Cartman or Foreigner. I'm going to go Foreigner. I Want to Know What Love Is.
All right, so Stacey is also saying Foreigner, as am I, because I remember the interview that we did, which obviously, Chris, you don't. So we're all saying Foreigner, I Want to Know What Love Is. Angela, is that correct?
It is correct, yes. You all got
that
right.
Yes, and I believe we can now hear that very moment.
My stepdad wrote I Want to Know What Love Is. He wrote it for my mom, so...
Oh, what? So. Hang on. I don't know this.
Amazing. What a guest. All right, Angela, question two, please.
Okay, question two. When Rick Astley was a guest on the show, he sang an emotional tribute song. But what was it a tribute to? Was it A, the NHS, B, T TV's Matt Baker, or C, the Lionesses?
All right.
I can't remember this. I remember Rick Astley being on.
Yeah, let's. These questions are great. Let's crack on.
Right.
Right. So, I think it was a tribute, weirdly, to Matt Baker, but I don't know why. I'm saying Matt Baker.
Stacey?
He left the one show, didn't he? But that, I don't know. I reckon it was the NHS. NHS.
See, now I think it is Matt Baker.
Yeah, so, but I don't know why.
I don't know why
we did this.
I'm going to say Matt Baker. Which of us is correct, please? Angela?
Yeah, Scott, you're right. It was Matt Baker.
Right,
yeah.
Okay. And let's hear why that even happened.
We'll see you on Country File. When you drive a lady's wild, you're the nicest guy. No one could hate you. When you do your rickshaw ride, you make our hearts swell with pride. Good luck, goodbye, Matt Baker. Yeah. Oh, Matt Baker.
So good.
We love you.
You wrote the lyrics to that.
Did I?
Yeah, you did. It was because
How do I not remember that? I'm concerned about my brain sometimes because
you wrote that.
You should remember that. Rick Astley singing a song about Matt Baker.
You should remember writing it.
Wow.
It's because he left the one show. So we
got
Rick Astley to do that fitting tribute. And question three, please, Angela.
Okay, question three. Gloria Estefan came on the show and told us how she was once offered one of these opportunities. Was it A, to be the first voice of Alexa, or B, to play the part of Bruce Willis's wife in Die Hard, or C, to become a spy for the CIA?
So Gloria Estefan came on the show, another massive guest, and she told us that she was once offered the chance to be the first voice of Alexa, to play the part of Bruce Willis's wife in Die Hard, or to become a spy for the CIA. Chris Stark.
I mean, I don't know. I'm going to say to become a spy for the CIA. She was so awesome.
Stacey.
I can't believe you got Gloria.
Yeah.
I'm obsessed with Gloria. Okay, let me think very quickly. The voice of Siri.
Alexa.
No. I've changed my mind. Bruce Willis's wife.
Also, if we keep saying Alexa, it really messes with people's smart speakers if they're listening.
Well, not now.
So stop saying Alexa.
Tail end of this show. Keep them listening.
Oh, actually.
Don't say it anymore.
Alexa.
No.
Play Five Live.
Yeah.
So my answer is to become a spy for the CIA. That's what Chris thinks as well. Stacey says first voice of smart speaker. Which is correct, Angela?
Okay, so you and Chris are correct. It was to become a spy for the CIA.
Have we got the clip? Yeah, we've got the clip.
I nearly joined the CIA.
Whoa.
When I was 18. What? Yes, I was recruited. I used to work at the Immigration and Customs. Apparently, there was somebody there in Customs that had met me and talked to me, and I didn't know that they were undercover, and they thought that I would make a great agent.
And that was Gloria Estefan on this show. Wow, that's the end of the quiz. Think about it. We had Robbie Williams, we had Mark Ronson, Rick Astley, Gloria Estefan, all over the last few years on the show. Final scores. Stacey has 1 point. Me and Chris have got 3 each, so we win.
Wow.
The tomato seed.
Oh, that's quite fitting.
That is lovely, actually.
Can we share
I'll
this?
I'll be putting them in the post to you.
Let's share this prize, Scott, with the management at Five Live as well that gave us this opportunity, I think. Heidi, Richard, Jono.
Yeah.
Well, this music's for you as well.
Yeah.
For having that faith in us.
Yeah, listen, Angela, thank you for the quiz. Send them in the post. That doesn't look weird at all. And Stacey, thank you for joining us.
Oh, all my love, gang. Keep shining. Enjoy your tomatoes.
We love you.
For a moment like this.
And that's about it. Thank you so much for letting us into your homes, your cars, and your headphones over the last few years. We have had an absolute blast.
Yeah, thank you so much to Five Live for literally letting us do this. Saturdays on Five Live, I really mean this, are unrivaled. Best commentators, best pundits, best journalists. It's always been part of my Saturday routine being a Watford fan. I still find it crazy, Scott, that they've let us be part of that Saturday lineup.
Yep.
It's been so special. And thank you to everyone who's taken part in the show. There's been so many. We've done so much stuff over the last couple of years. If you've called or texted us, told us a stupid story, reviewed your mum's terrible taste in music, this show was all about you.
And do you remember at the very start, we could not quite believe that the world's greatest rugby referee agreed to regularly come on the show. And he used his refereeing skills to sort out your often very minor arguments and disputes. We called it Real Life TMO. And so, as his decision is always final, the last words should go to him.
Absolutely. Now, let's level with everyone, Scott. Here's the situation. We've acquired this recording.
Yeah.
Me and Scott haven't actually heard this yet.
Mm-hmm. This is the first time for all of us.
Sir Nigel sent his vocal across via WhatsApp voice note to our producer, and I've been assured it's going to be a fitting tribute to us. Let's do this. Take it away, Sir Nigel Owens.
Should Kate and Graham have a gender reveal party, Nigel?
No, Graham, I'm with you on this. No need for one.
Doors or wheels?
Doors.
Just to check, the person in the middle seat on the plane gets both armrests.
Correct.
Decision given.
And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. Each week on TMO, you state your case, I put the ref's shirt on. I ruled on your disputes, laid down the law, but in a kind way, I made sure that in the end, you did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you could tell, when your disputes were pointless as hell. But through it all, when there was doubt, I heard it all and figured it out. Let the record show, I'm the TMO.
Nigel, is it okay for Kirsty to change her son's name, or is 3 years old too late?
3 years old is too late.
A starter or a pudding?
A starter for me.
Yes, you did it. Nigel's way.
Sorry, that was beautiful.
That was the best.
Wow. Thank you for listening, everyone. All of our shows, all of our podcasts are on BBC Sounds. Just look for Scott Mills and Chris Stark.
Patrick Kilty starts in 2 weeks, and we'll see you on the other side. Look after yourselves, take care of each other, and thank you so much for listening.
Hi, I'm Dr. Julia Shaw.
And I'm Sophie Hagen.
Our podcast, Bad People, is back for a new season. Every week, we combine true crime and research from criminal psychology to investigate the deliciously dark question.
Why do people do bad things?
In this season, we dig into questions like, can video games ever cause violence?
I mean, how are you meant to react to that?
Do doctors need dark humor?
No, I never ever want to hear that again.
And what rights does a dead body have?
That is horrible.
Bad People is back. Listen on BBC Sounds.